Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Good evening.
Welcome to the University of the District of Columbia and the 2016 HBCU Awards. We are so very excited that you have chosen to spend the evening with us this evening for our annual celebration of the achievements and noteworthy contributions of historically black colleges and universities. My name is John Gordon. I am the communications director here at the University of the District of Columbia. And we're here tonight to celebrate what makes the HBCU experience the backbone not only of the African-American culture, but of the black American experience. Tonight, we will honor those who captured the attention of their campuses and communities through excellence in communications, academics, research, athletics, advocacy, and leadership. These awards presented here this evening will help to tell a story that far too often goes downplayed, washed over, or not told at all in our national narratives of these institutions that we know are so very important. Despite the obstacles, our HBCUs have remained in the business of excellence, despite whatever the political and the socioeconomic climates may be. Like each of you, the University of the District of Columbia is proud to be a part of that family of institutions referred to as an historically black college or university. But here at UDC, we are also proud of our singular distinction of being the only urban land-grant institution in the nation. Right now, I want to introduce someone who will bring greetings on behalf of our president, Ronald Mason, who unfortunately could not join us here this evening. And I'd like for you to welcome one of my colleagues, my boss, who is the executive director of external affairs here at UDC, Michelle Cusho.
Welcome, everyone. Welcome here to the University of the District of Columbia. On behalf of President Ronald Mason, I want to thank you for coming. I hope you've been able to enjoy DC while you're here, because there's so much to see and do. To those of you who are here for the conference, I have loved my past 2 days working with you in the conference. What we've learned and done in that atmosphere has really grown my knowledge, my connections with you all from around the country, and it's been a really great exercise. Tonight, I know this gathering is going to be filled with joy, and I just hope you'll enjoy it as much as I am. Again, welcome to the University of the District of Columbia, and please enjoy yourself and make yourself at home. Thank you.
I want to call on Jared Carter to come and give the invocation.
Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for safe travel. We thank you for the protection over the highways and byways, Father. We thank you for the blessing that is historically black colleges and universities and all that you bring to this nation. Despite being unheralded, underfunded, and underappreciated, you still made a way for more than 150 years. We just ask at this moment that you allow this meal and this gathering, this ceremony, to be a reflection of the great grace that you've shown to our institutions, that you've shown to our people. It's a nasty that you've given us as an expression to these black colleges, and through them, the offshoot of our excellence in industry and outreach, Father. We just ask that you bless the food that we're about to receive, that you bless the hands that prepared them and mouths that are to receive, and that everything we do be a reflection of your grace and your eternal mercy in our lives. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Be brave. Go further. Tuskegee's tradition, your trajectory. I thumbed through the program booklet, and those are some of the words that were listed in the various program ads. These words represent the mission, purpose, and core values of our HBCU family. And tonight we're here to celebrate and recognize the quality, excellence, service, and commitment of the various HBCU institutions. So without further ado, we're going to start our awards presentation. First, by making the presentations and awards in student activities.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's my pleasure to be here with you this evening. My name is Jennifer Robinson. I am a graduate of Morgan State University in Baltimore. I will be presenting the awards in student activities. We are going to start with Best Marching Band. In the category of Best Marching Band, we have Southern University, Human Jukebox, Prairie View A&M University, Marching Storm, Virginia State University, Trojan, Florida A&M University, Marching 100, and Albany State University, Marching Band. Your winner for the Best Marching Band is Southern University.
Good evening. On behalf of our President Chancellor, Dr. Ray Belton, certainly thank you. Many of you saw the Southern University Human Jukebox play Adele. You have it on repeat on your screen saver. Certainly, when the Human Jukebox is mentioned, it is appropriate to drop the mic.
in conjunction with Common College, North Carolina, fought arguably against that. We're at the forefront of some very serious voter rights issues. Thank you, North Carolina, there's a lot of issues. So they're at the forefront of that one. So I'll accept this on the Aggie tag.
Our last award is for Best Student Organization. Florida A&M Honda Honda Campus All-Star Team, Virginia State Girls at the Gate, Edward Waters Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated Chi Chapter, SULC of the National Lawyers Guild, Houston Tittleston Green is the New Black. The winner for Best Student Organization is Virginia State.
These two ladies, I want you to know, every morning from their freshman year to their senior year, they just graduated in May, they were up at 5:30 a.m. walking our campus and praying for the university and all of the communities around it. Did it consistently for 4 years and missed not a day. Glory be to God. Amen. Wow. How about those Trojans, huh? Yeah.
Congratulations to all of the winners in the student activities category. We're going to move on to awards in publications at this time.
My name is Calvin Hayes, a proud 2010 graduate of Florida A&M University. Tonight is my pleasure to present the awards of publication for the best student newspaper, Southern Digest, Norfolk State Spartan Echo, Hampton Script, North Carolina Central University Campus Echo, North Carolina A&T Register, and the winner is North Carolina Central University Campus Echo. Central University Now Magazine and Oakwood Magazine. Yeah. And the winner is Oakwood.
Yeah. Our first award. First of all, thank you, God. Thank you, Mom. Thank you, Mom. One of the things that I remember, I've only been at Oakwood for 2.5 years now, and Jawan Sanders is one of our students who's sitting at our table. And he came, Jawan came into our office and Oakwood Magazine was sitting on my table. I just finished my first issue, very proud of our first issue. Jawan said, "What is that?" And I said, "Oh, it's Oakwood Magazine." He said, "I didn't know we had a magazine." That was a very telling story of the job that I had to do. And I asked him, I said, "Would you read this?" He said, "No." So we had to make changes. And I want to thank Jawan for giving us that information to make the changes that we needed to make so that students, alumni, prospective students would read our magazine. Thank you, Jawan.
Awards in academic excellence.
Center, Delaware State Optical Science Center, Southern University Library.
Good evening, everyone. I greet you this evening in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and I bring you greetings on behalf of the administration, Dr. Brown, Dr. Dillis, faculty, and the students of Southern University and the Annual College. It is an enormous honor for me to stand before you and to accept this award, and I do so both personally and privately. As I look back on my life, I had came from a family where we were the first children to go to college. We had eight kids, six of whom attended HBCUs in the state of Louisiana alone. Different university. Southern University that knew it, Brandon State University, and Southern University in New Orleans as well, included in that group. Well, I could go on personally. I met my wife for 45 years at Southern University. She can't be here tonight because she's speaking in Denver, Colorado right now. Otherwise, she would be here. We have two children, both of whom attended HBCU, Howard University here in Washington, D.C. And my son-in-law did also. And they tell me that in a year or two, we're going to have a grandson who's going to go to Howard University. So hopefully I've convinced you by now that the HBCU experience is in my blood, but yet I've embedded in my DNA. And so it's something that I take a lot of pride in. And then this evening is what I'm going to say a couple of things with regard to the recognition that it carries for our university and for HBCUs everywhere. Southern University is the only HBCU member of the Library Scientific Collaboration. So we are a founding partner, that center, in Livingston, Louisiana. So I take a lot of pride in that myself. And also, we're the only HBCU member of what's called the Library Scientific Collaboration. And you know, I don't want to go on, okay? But let me just say that this experiment that we work on is the largest single physics experiment in the history of the National Science Foundation. Back in February, we announced the detection, the observation of gravitational waves. And I'm going to stick my neck out right here and just say that's probably the single most significant science finding in the last century. Okay, so thank you. And I hope that another clap to say I'm going to finish up. No, but I'm very proud of it, no question about it. And so as we go forward, I would simply say thank you. Thank you to the awards committee, okay, for this recognition. I want to thank also all of the people from Southern University, the library, and the National Science Foundation who helped make this outcome a reality. Thank you so very much, and as we go forward with God's help, as we have to always, okay, let's do so in such a way that we continue the proud legacy of our HBCUs to the benefit of future generations. Thank you very much.
Our next category is Best Fine Arts Program, and we have Hampton University, Players and Company, Alabama State University College of Visual and Performing Arts, Morgan State University Screenwriting and Animation Program, Norfolk State University Division of Drama, and Texas Southern University Department of Music. And the winner is Hampton University.
President Edison O. Jackson and Dean Dr. Ida Wright, I proudly accept this award for our College of Business and Entrepreneurship. We are definitely committed to our community. We are the heart of Midtown, and we do a lot in our community for small businesses and those who seek to be business owners, with incubators, business classes, free to the community. So we're very proud of our business program, and we look forward to seeing you all next year for more awards.
The next category, Best Science, Technology, Engineering, and Mathematics Program. We have North Carolina A&T State University, Center of Excellence in Post-Harvest Technology, North Carolina Central University Bio Research Institute and Technology Enterprise, Florida A&M University College of Pharmaceutical Science, Tuskegee University School of Engineering, and Morehouse School of Medicine National Center for Primary Care. And the winner is North Carolina Central University
On behalf of my chancellor, Dr. Deborah Saunders-White, who is here, as well as Dr. Undy Huffler, who serves as our interim vice chancellor for research and economic development, I think we accept this award on behalf of all the researchers in BRIGHT, which is the acronym, who work tirelessly fighting diseases such as pancreatic cancer, uterine fibroids, hypertension, and diabetes at BRIGHT. And so we accept this award on behalf of them and the hopefully the cure that they'll come up with for those diseases. So thank you so much for HBCU Awards and HBCU Bio.
The next category, Best Social Work Program. And we have North Carolina Central University, Fayetteville State University, and Southern University at New Orleans. And the winner is Fayetteville State University.
On behalf of our Chancellor, Dr. James A. Anderson, our Provost, Dr. Young, and our Dean of College of Arts and Sciences, Dr. Sam Dunyuku, I thank you for this award, but we cannot do this without our great social work students. And that's why we're here to serve our students, and we are very proud of them, and we like bragging about them. So thank you so much for this award. Thank you.
And for our last category, and Best Nursing / Health Program, we have North Carolina Central University Department of Nursing, Tuskegee University Department of Occupational Therapy, and Winston-Salem State University Occupational Therapy Program. And the winner is Tuskegee University Department of Occupational Therapy.
Brian Lamont Johnson, and the head of the Nursing and Occupational Therapy Department, Joyce Holman, I graciously accept this award, and I cannot say enough about what they do to make sure that they prepare the next generation of medical professionals, from Skype sessions to late night, just sessions on the board exams. They work tirelessly to help our students, and with that legacy, we expect to collect more of these in the future.
Hello, HBCU family. My name is Jennifer Langston. I am a proud graduate of North Carolina Central University, and also a former student of HBCU. I will be presenting the awards and alumni activity. We're going to start with the Alumnus of the Year, and the nominees are Kenya Ferris, Clark Atlanta University, Sashi Brown, Hampton University, Ruffus Wilson, Bethune-Cookman University, Damon Lee III, Tennessee State University, and Keith Alexander, Howard University. And the winner is Sashi Brown.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Matthew White. I am a proud alumnus of Hampton as well as a PR specialist in the Office of University Relations. Unfortunately, Unfortunately, Mr. Sashi Brown could not be in attendance tonight. On January 3rd, he was named the VP of Personnel Management for the Cleveland Browns. So for all of our football fans here in attendance, you know the Browns need as much hands-on help as they need right now. So Sashi is at work in Cleveland trying to fix that garbage fire. But I'm from Ohio, so I can say that. But Jay and HBC Digest and to all of our HB family, thank you and keep up the good work, Jay.
Adrian Lofton, Howard University. Marilyn Mosby, Tuskegee University. Atasha Murray, Clark Atlanta University. Brenda Stiff, Virginia State University. Janine Mitchell, Tennessee State University.
I graciously accept this award. Thank you so much, HBCU Digest, and thank you, HBCU Nation.
Our next category, Awards in Athletic Excellence.
Good evening, everyone. I am Kendall Sunshine Hayes, a former Miss Florida A&M University, and the 2012 HBCU Digest Female Student of the Year. I'm going to be presenting Awards in Athletic Excellence, starting with the category of Female Coach of the Year. Our nominees are Anne Marie Gilbert from Virginia Union University, Chandra Cheeseborough-Geese of Tennessee State University, Hannah Lowing of Xavier University of Louisiana, and Nadine Domond from Grambling State University. And the winner is Chandra Cheeseborough-Geese of Tennessee State University.
My name is Cassandra Greaves, and I serve as the Director of Alumni Relations and Engagement at Tennessee State University.
it is with immense excitement that I accept this award on behalf of Coach Cheese, as we like to call her. Coach Cheese is a four-time gold and silver medalist. She is an Olympic coach, but most importantly, she is a great mentor to the students who go through the athletic program at Tennessee State University. And I'd like to thank the HBCU Digest on her behalf.
For our next category, Male Coach of the Year, our nominees are Dana Ford of Tennessee State University, Rob Broadway of North Carolina A&T State University, Lawrence Spooner-Clark of Bethune-Cookman University, Mervo Melendez of Alabama State University, Willie Slater of Tuskegee University, and Mike Newell of Dillard University. And the winner is Mervo Melendez of Alabama State University.
So I'm going to accept this on behalf of Coach Melendez. For those who don't know, he's one of the greatest contemporary HBCU baseball coaches. He had a dominant run as head coach of Bethune-Cookman.
Yeah.
I think 11 straight in the NCAA. He went to Alabama State 2 years ago in this past season. The Hornets finished 29-0 in conference play, and won, which is the first time they've ever been done in SWAC history. And they also won the SWAC Conference Championship. I think because of that success, he was recently named head coach of Florida International University. So, Coach Melendez, I'll accept that.
And the next category is Female Athlete of the Year. Our nominees are Kiana Johnson of Virginia Union University, Victoria Elizabeth of Houston Tillotson University, Noriana Haynes of Alcorn State University, and Amber Hughes of Tennessee State University. The winner is Noriana Haynes of Alcorn State University.
Players in the SWAC this past season earned SWAC Player of the Year. By most estimates, will likely be on the WNBA roster sometime in the near future. So I'll accept this for all.
For the category of Male Athlete of the Year, we have Devin Gales of Southern University, Demetric Austin of Dillard University, Tariq Cohen of North Carolina A&T State University, and Javon Hargrave of South Carolina State University. And the winner is Devin Gale at Southern University.
On behalf of our athletic department, this is certainly a very tragic award to accept. Many of you probably recall the national conversation about HBCUs at Division I athletics. Devin played against the University of Georgia, sustained a serious spinal injury that brought paralysis. And certainly, let's keep him, his family, and well wishes for better health. Thank you.
For the next category, Women's Team of the Year, our nominees are Virginia Union University Women's Basketball Team, Xavier University of Louisiana Women's Basketball Team, Hampton University Track and Field Team, St. Augustine University's track and field team, and Winston-Salem State University's softball team. And the winner is St. Augustine University track and field team.
All they accept is St. Augustine. Many of you who are in the CIAA, y'all are getting over it against St. Augustine. One of the more dynamic track programs in the country at any division. They recently captured, I think, their 42nd NCAA championship, total championship. And they have several athletes that are going to be competing in the field this summer. So today, head coach George Williams, and on behalf of St. Augustine's, I'll accept it.
For the final category, Athlete of the Year, Awards of Athletic Excellence. For the category of Men's Team of the Year, we have Alcorn State University Football, North Carolina A&T State University's Football, Dillard University Men's Basketball Team, Xavier University's Men's Tennis Team, and Tennessee State University's Men's Basketball Team. And the winner is
North Carolina A&T State University football team.
Having not played a sport in years, I've accepted a lot of athletic awards. I'll accept this on the Aggie behalf. A lot of us who follow Black College football remember A&T Longhorn played in the inaugural celebration bowl, which brought tremendous exposure to HBCUs as the first bowl game of the college bowl team. It was an outstanding game in which A&T prevailed. So I'll accept this again on the Aggie behalf.
Mr. Jarrett, I appreciate all the things that you have helped me with. I appreciate it. Thank you. And also the HBCU family. Appreciate it. Wow.
Our next category, female
Idonia Barrett, Hampton University. Rhonda Spurlock, Southern University. Elania Jemison Hudson, Morehouse College. Kadiah Nicole Green, Tuskegee University and Morehouse School of Medicine. And the winner is Kadiah Nicole Green, Tuskegee University and Morehouse School of Medicine.
Once again, on behalf of our president, Dr. Brian L. Johnson, and also on behalf of our provost, Cesar Herman, I graciously accept this award. One personal note, Dr. Hadea Green, even though she has moved on from the students, is one of the brightest lights in the HBCU world. It is a pleasure and an honor to have worked with her when she was blowing up all over the world for being a brilliant scientist. She was the most humble person in the world. When a person does such groundbreaking research, it can get to the ego that never happened before. And one of the things I do love about her is when we were setting things up for people and we had to kind of borrow a classroom because she wasn't teaching at the time and we had to set something up. Instead of just going through the motions and marking it, she decided to inspire the students and leave a message for them each classroom that we had to borrow. And I will forever love her for that. Follow this woman. It is bright lights like her that reminds us of why we do what we do with you all, to shine a light on people like her. And so as long as we're doing that, there's nothing that we cannot show the world. Thank you.
Just so y'all know what she actually did. I think it was last fall, she received $1 million grant for innovative cancer treatment, which was not a group grant, but $1 million individual grant for individual research at this team. And this was a competitive federal grant that people from all over the country, Stanford, Harvard, MIT, are applying for, and she got it. So this is one of our, Terry Wright, this is one of our preeminent scientists at a historical black college. She went to Tuskegee and Warren School of Medicine. So again, a great person to know, just very thoroughly know exactly what she is.
Our final category, Male Faculty Member of the Year, Stephen McGuire, Southern University, Robert Collins, Dillard University, Gregory Henderson, Winston-Salem State University, Gregory Henry, Tennessee State University, and the winner is Stephen McGuire, Southern University.
Well, I already gave a speech. Let me simply say that many words cannot describe just how important and how significant this recognition is to me. On January 5th, 1998, I first learned about something called the LIHO Project being built in my home state. Learning about that experiment, I decided right then, even though I was a faculty member at Cornell University, that it was time to go home and to work on that project. Like, you know, you can't always go home. So I'm grateful for the ability to, in fact, go back home and indeed contribute to this effort, which has resulted in the outcome that I talked about earlier, having to do with the scientific stuff. So let me just say that I just can't thank the HBCU Award Committee enough for considering me for this award.
give all praise and all glory to God. For it was even given. Amen. And I ask you to continue prayer and your support that we move along and to take this development and turn it into something even greater for our HBCUs. Thank you very much.
So it's my privilege to begin the announcement for the highest honors of the evening. Female male, the presidents of the year, the HBCU of the year. So it would be my distinct pleasure to welcome to the podium to announce the female president of the year. A good mentor. Someone who's been almost a lifelong for the HBCU event. Great experience in fundraising. Connecting folks to corporate opportunities. Dr. Cookman, coming up.
Good evening. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Are you sure? I want to make sure because this is so exciting. For the first time in the history of our HBCUs, we can claim 19 female presidents. That's about one-fifth of all of the presidents of our 105 historically black colleges and universities. As I was looking over the list of the nominees, all of them are actually female presidents of the year. But for purposes of tonight and this award, there can only be one. But let me just tell you who they are. Dr. Tashni Andrew-Roy is the youngest HBCU president. I believe she's 32. Is that right, Dr.?
35.
See, I was trying to get the sister. Okay, fine. That's so good. That's so great. She is the second permanent president of Shaw University. There have been three female presidents. Dr. Yancey, those of you know her from Johnson C. Smith, she was interim. But Dr. DuBois is actually the second permanent. Dr. Glenda Baskin Glover. Dr. Baskin Glover would be here tonight, but some of you who may share pink and green with me. First, second, and third cousins. But I have to pay homage to Alpha Kappa Alpha. This past week, we were in Atlanta, 30,000 strong, and our sister, Dr. Glenda Baskin Glover, will become the supreme basilisk at our next boulet in 2 years. So she kind of officiated in second place this time, so you can understand running a major institution, receiving the award Tennessee State has already received tonight, and then being able to shepherd our illustrious sorority through the next 4 years. She couldn't be here. Our third nominee is Dr. Deborah Saunders White. Dr. Deborah Saunders White is, in fact, the first permanent female president at North Carolina Central University. Dr. Deborah Saunders White, you met her earlier this evening, but she's here, and I'm going to ask her to stand up again because you indeed are a female president of the year. An Alpha Kappa Alpha woman. Our third nominee of the evening is Dr. Cynthia Jackson Hammond. She is the eighth president of Central State University and the first female president of Central State University. She too is an Alpha Kappa Alpha. Change what's already working well, but maintain the strengths and buttress the weaknesses. Being forward-thinking
means changing what needs to be changed and bolstering what needs to be in place. Founded in 1887 as a land grant, but somehow got lost in the translation, but in 2014 became the official land grant institution under the presidency and leadership of this president. In the fall, this institution will constitute an agricultural education program. As part of its land grant mission, it is taken to new heights, areas in, of pursuit relative to science, technology, engineering, arts, and math. It gives me great pleasure this evening to open the envelope, and I'm assuming this is the envelope. Of the president, and I think you know me. That's okay, though. If you want it to be red, it's red. If you need it to be blue and white, or blue and gold, it's blue and white, or blue and gold. But this evening, it gives me great pleasure to present to you the female president of the year. My friend, my colleague, as you all are, but for this evening, you gotta be number one, Dr. Cynthia
to recognize my dear husband, Dr. James Hammond, my son, Christopher Hammond, and the others who are at my table, raise your hand, I won't go through all the names, who have always been supportive, and they are members of HBCU families as well. But I really do accept this award on behalf of all of those who could not attend an HBCU, all of the Tamir Rices, all of the Alton Sterling, all of the Castiles, all of the young men and women who had a dream unfulfilled. As an HBCU president, we know what that means. And we know that we must educate, love, nurture, but not enable students just because we love them. But we must protect them and give them the tools to be successful in this very, very challenging world. And if anyone ever says to you that an HBCU is not relevant, apparently they never attended one. In this great country of ours, and HBCU Digest, I thank you for this award. God bless
you. It never fails. I always joke about this at church. Every time I get up, it's always following somebody who says something dynamic. And then as simple as I am, it's just a complete letdown. So thank you, Dr. Henry. Extraordinary vote to say the least. Again, congratulations. It's my pleasure to introduce the male, the nominees, the male president. Now, Dr. Williams has again embarrassed me, making me look something more simple than I am. This collection of brothers, and I truly call them brothers because they exemplify some of the best characteristics of black men in leadership. They do for their community, they're concerned about it, and they use their profile at the head of HBCU to truly make a difference in some areas that really stand in need of it. And so tonight, our nominees for Male President of the Year are Dr. James Anderson, Fayetteville State University. Dr. Michael Sorrell, Paul Quinn College. Dr. Harry Williams, Delaware State University. Jackson of the Bethune-Cookman University. Our 2016 Male President of the Year, for the second time, Michael Sorrell.
Jared, I have been coming to this event from the beginning, and I know the struggle that it takes to do for us. Anything, right? I got the amen corner over here, right? Jared and his family, because let's be honest, keeping the kids, they're next door, right? What he does, we need done.
Yeah.
What he says, we need said. And there is a price you pay when you speak truth to the illusion of power. And he does that consistently, he does it tirelessly, and he does it with no regard to the financial consequences of speaking up and saying what needs to be done. And for your courage, I salute you, and I think we should all give him a salute. I am incredibly honored and humbled to receive this award. I love my HBCU community. My mother went to an HBCU. My grandmother went to an HBCU. My sister is a graduate of Talladega College. My cousin went to Morehouse. My wife went to Spelman. Hampton has another one of my cousins. Another cousin, we're in the Florida A&M band. We are an HBCU family. I didn't go. But I might add, I'm the only one who's president of an HBCU. But HBCUs mean everything to me, and they mean everything to us. And I just want to say something, two things before I sit down. First of all, to my sister president, Dr. Saunders White, I know the struggle that you are going through with your health. And I just want to say that I follow what you do. I understand that struggle because my mother had that struggle. And I am so amazed and inspired by how you show up to do your job at a high level every day while you battle what you battle. And I just want to publicly say, I am proud to share this moment in time with you and to share this designation as an HBCU president with you. And if you don't know, you have one hell of a fan down in Dallas, Texas. And thank you for all you do, and even under the conditions in which you do it. So I just want to say thank you. I want to say no disrespect to Sister Hamilton One. I'm a Central State fan. We played you all when I was in college, and I love coming down there. But thank you for your hard work and the excellence in which you do what you do. I just want to say this. Our people need us right now. Amen. If you are not paying attention, our communities, our brothers, our sisters are under attack. If we don't use our collective voices now, what are we waiting on? Why do we stand by idly and watch our young brothers be abused continuously? These last two shootings, they weren't resisting, y'all. They were doing what we have told our sons to do. They were doing what our parents told us to do. If you are stopped, do not resist. They were not resisting. We watched them die. We watched them die. And yet we don't speak up. And yet we sit on our hands and we don't use our voices and we don't use our institutions to fight the wrong which we know is wrong. Now I'm not telling you that you have to go out and challenge the police. That's not what I'm saying. What I am telling you is we have to challenge an unjust system which created the conditions which allowed these things to occur. This is our legacy. This is what we have always done. This is who we have always been. If we did not speak up, who was going to speak up? We are the birthplace of the notion that Black lives matter. That is what we were founded on. It is our time. If we don't speak up now, if we don't advocate now, if we don't protect our people now, then you have no right to be upset when anyone asks, are you relevant again? This is when you prove your relevancy. This is when you prove your intensity. This is when you prove your merit. This is what we were built for. Now, this is what we believe at Paul Quinn College. This is our credo. Our institutional ethos is we over me. The needs of the community supersede the wants of the individual. You don't get to be silent and you don't get to be selfish at Paul Quinn College. We advocate whether we had 150 students or if we are five times as large. We stand up for what we believe in. And what we believe in more than anything else is you and us. And all I'm saying to you tonight, all I'm saying to you as we go forward, our people, our communities need us to be the truest, best selves of truest, best version of ourselves. Our children need to see us standing up and being advocates for what is right in this society, challenging this nation to live up to the American ideal. That doesn't make you wrong. That doesn't make you militant. That makes you an American. That makes you the best of what this country has to offer. And as I take my seat, I want to say thank you to those of you who stand up and fight every day. I want to say thank you to Destiny Modesty, who 3-4 years ago took a chance when I visited her high school in Brooklyn, New York, and talked her out of Tuskegee, talked her out of Hampton, talked her out of Spelman, told her to come be part of the Quinai Nation, and she has represented us amazingly well for each day that she has been there. I want to say thank you to our new Vice President of Academic Affairs, Julie Amon, who's here, and I want to say thank you to all of you for believing in the dream that is us, believing in the dream that is our institution, and I look forward to doing the work that we do with you each day as we move forward, and I beg of you, use your voices. Thank you.
Thank you again, Big Brother. This one guy in the coalition of HBCU presidents and leaders who I really count on as confidants, advisors, and just folks who just really care. Such a precious resource, such an endangered resource. Everybody who's present here knows what they feel the best is like. So we thank you, ma'am, sir, thank you. I'm going to stand in for Mr. Nicholas Perkins, who was here earlier. He actually presented this actual event, helped us to finance it. He's actually the founder and CEO of Perkins Management Services Incorporated. It's a food service company. He's a graduate of Fayetteville State University. He had to leave early because one of his family members, I believe, took ill in D.C. He had to rush to Washington, and I don't think he would make it back. But I just want to just give him some credit because he was a guy who, while a student at Fayetteville State, started his company, a one-man operation. And today, he's one of the biggest black-owned food service companies in the country. With a special $1 million company, started by himself, graduate of Fayetteville, and has special care for and concern about black colleges, has endowed millions of dollars at black colleges all over the country. And will call me any time of the day and say, bro, man, we gotta do something about these HBCUs. Not in a negative way, but like we have to save these schools. And there's no dollar amount, there's no mile he won't travel to do that. So even though he's not here, I just wanted you guys to know what kind of brother he is. What kind of support he's lending to me and my family, and this event in particular. These nominees for HBCU of the Year all exhibited great characteristics of institutional pride, high research and activity, community engagement, excellence across a number of fields, including athletics, student life, and otherwise. All of them are very deserving. All of them are invaluable to their state and community. And so again, I just want to congratulate each and every nominated institution for the example they set for the HBCU landscape. Our nominees for HBCU of the Year, Delaware State University, North Carolina Central University, Tuskegee University, North Carolina A&T State University, Paul Quinn College, Winston-Salem State University, and Tennessee State University. And it is my honor to present to you the 2016 Historically Black College and University of the Year, North Carolina Central University.
Just stand on the shoulders of some of those who've come before. Michael, I think you're phenomenal. And the things that you're doing in Texas really are innovative and are really changing the landscape of the narrative on HBCUs. Cynthia, you fought a hell of a fight, girl. To have earned that distinction is quite an honor. And I am so proud to call you Sora and Sister Preston. You know, Harry, you know, you didn't have too far to come. You are a phenomenal leader in our conference and a phenomenal role model to me. You took my calls late at night and helped me through some very difficult times. So I appreciate all of you. North Carolina is a wonderful state, some would say. But it truly is a great place and great opportunity, particularly for children of color. It is our mission, it is our singular goal as historically black colleges and universities, particularly in North Carolina, is to ensure that each and every student in our state has the same opportunity at a better life. So let me share with you what I say to my colleagues at Duke, who are less than 5 miles away, my colleagues at Chapel Hill, who are probably a little further, maybe 8 miles away, and NC State, who happens to be about 15 miles away. I pray for them each and every night, and I said to their presidents and to their chancellors, let me tell you, I know it's a hell of a burden living in our shadow. I don't mean that, because we are in the business of providing some of the most extraordinary talent to the global marketplace. And we as HBCU chancellors and presidents and alumni and affinity groups to our institutions must believe that in our soul. And it's up to us to tell the story. The pages are often filled with all of the heartbreaking news. But when you hear that 85 people were really slaughtered today, it has become so common practice, we'll say, we hear that news and just say, where's the salt? That is what we have become reduced to. And when we see our young black men doing what they need to do or should do or what we practice and taught them to do and receiving the type of consequences they had, it's heartbreaking. But we are on the front lines. And not only do we need to talk about what we give to our communities, we must talk about truly the type of talent that's making a difference in the intellectual landscape of, in the intellectual discourse of our conversation. We have a criminal justice program at North Carolina Central University. And I will tell you, of the 8 police chiefs in our state and in our geography, 6 of them came out of our program. Now, if you talk about how we protect our communities, think about that level of diversity. We all need to take charge of whatever the dynamic is. Are we educating nurses? Are we educating engineers? Are we educating farmers? Are we educating lawyers or teachers? Whatever the discipline is, we do it better than anybody else. Not because of, but in spite of. Because, and I'm spiritual, it is because the Lord has put us in this place. And we have to take advantage, full advantage, of being leaders at historically black colleges and universities. So those who come to the table and talk about relevancy, those that come to the table and want to know, well, what have you done? Be sure sure to tell them the complete story. We talk about some of the brightest students that we make available. But I will tell you, I ask every nurse that has come, has had the opportunity to, I've had care from, so where'd you graduate from? Where'd you go to school? And how heartwarming is it to know that the nurse's assistant, the physician assistant, all came out of our beautiful schools. So we are the fabric of America. Make no mistake about it. North Carolina Teachers University, I am just honored to stand on so many great shoulders who come before me there. You keep us close in prayer, eagles soar. And we will continue to do what we do, do it to the best of our abilities. Can I ask my team to stand, please? Can you guys please stand? I just get the honor of being called chancellor every day. They're the guys that really do the work. Thank you so very much. Come to North Carolina often. And North Carolina Central will always welcome you.
Again, let's give all of our men. Just a few words of thanks. First, to the University of District of Columbia. Thank you so much for being such a hospital. We really appreciate it. For those of you who don't know, UDC is an institution, 4-year community college and law school. So one of our most comprehensive institutions historically black or otherwise in the country. It's really making a difference in Ron Mason and his team for DC and beyond. So thank you again for hosting us. For those who don't know, this award ceremony is also in conjunction with an annual training that we do for public relations officials and communications folks. This year we were able to do that as one of our highest turnouts ever. So again, thank you institutions for sending your people to be a part of the dialogue. We co-convene that, Evangel Media, CEO Art Marnett, thank you to her. Thank you to the entire UDC team, John Gordon, our distinguished MC for this evening, who's also the communications director. Thank you to all of the presidents who showed up. This is one of the largest attendances we've had, sitting presidents here. It means so much to me that you guys think so much about this award. It's the only one we have. But the fact that you guys thought enough to come up and down and vote for this, it really means the world to me. It means the world to me. Because you guys, every single thing I do, you guys give me legitimacy. All I'm doing is telling the story. You guys are putting boots to the ground and getting these students out and making a difference in our world. So to all of you guys, thank you so much. Thank you so much for coming. I can't say that enough. To my wonderful family, everything that goes right with the digest is not because of me, it's because of my lovely wife for 9 years, Nikia. Everything that goes wrong is me. Everything that goes right is her. Not just an inspiration inside and outside our home, her work ethic, her commitment, her loyalty. Just so many of the things that you would want in a best friend to be a role model. And I get that every day. So I'm so appreciative. Thank you so much for everything you do. Our two little boys, Jared Jr. and Landon, they're 6 and 4, so they don't really do too much to help the dad. But they're such an inspiration in terms of trying to get good work done, so when I'm not here, hopefully they'll see that I was somebody that tried to make a difference in something, particularly for black boys. So it's just an honor to be here. My parents, the kids' parents, but my parents too, Iris Harris, Bobby Harris, thank you guys so much. I call them my parents that easy because they really are my parents. I've never caught an in-law bath from a day in my life. It's just so much a part of me. It's so grateful to you guys for all the stuff you do for us. to the folks that present this evening, some of our dear friends, thank you so much for coming out from Baltimore traffic, DC traffic, to do such an extraordinary job of presenting these winners and nominees. You guys are phenomenal. Thank you so much. And to everybody who has an affinity for support for HBCUs, it's been said so eloquently throughout the evening how much they're needed, despite of how treacherous your job is, despite all the political and social pressure you face for them to be shut down or to go away. You guys persevere, not just because of pride, but because it's where you went, because you know what kind of difference it makes. You know that they're the economic engines in our community. You know they're the cultural engines in our community. And it's always been said that we didn't have them, we have to make them. And so because of you guys, we don't have to make them. They're living in each and every one of us. So I just can't express how much you guys mean to me. I know I get a lot of trouble because I talk a lot of trash and you guys, but I've tried to frame that around the truth that needs to be told. And in the event that we're not here, even one of us, somebody can know the difference we tried to make, even if one of our institutions didn't make it. So I hope you guys will realize that. I hope you enjoyed it. And I hope you will, wherever we are next year, that you will again do this. Second week of July. Remains to be seen where. Somewhere warm. And somewhere on an HBCU campus. I would advise that if God will allow it, I would never be out off an HBCU campus. We don't need to be in a fancy hotel. We don't need to be in a fancy conference center. We're just fine at home.
Amen.
We're just fine at home. So again, thank you so much to all the winners, Virginia State, Tennessee State, Southern, everybody who made noise throughout the evening. Thank y'all so much. Again, please travel safely, and I look forward to speaking with you. Thank you.